Welcome to Annapolis Lutheran Church. As always, it's a pleasure to be with you and to worship alongside of you. If you're visiting with us this morning, special welcome to you. We invite you to fill out one of our Connect cards, or you can connect with us with the QR code on the back of the bulletin. For everyone here today, please take a few minutes to look at the back of the bulletin where our announcements are. There's plenty of ways for you to get involved here in the ministry at Annapolis Lutheran Church. So let us now stand and continue our worship with the confession. We do have one announcement.
Okay, folks, we're in our second week of the Miracle of Christmas. I think everyone knows pretty much how it operates. I do have the sign-up sheet for the food boxes if you would like to shop for the food for one of the 15 families we're doing this for. There's a sign-up sheet and an envelope and the money to shop for the food. See me in the back table. And there's plenty of gift tags left. We have about 50, I think. Maybe a little more. So if you have any questions, see me, and we'll go from there. Oh, if you do sign up for a food box, it will be across the hall in the fellowship hall. You can't miss the boxes. And just take the one that corresponds to your number, family. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. Minister, you've been involved there for several years. Very blessed.
Let us now continue our service. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We confess our sins. God, who is faithful and just,
will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us, in all honesty,
hear his word again and confess our sins. The Lord has consecrated his guest.
But we have been more attentive.
Build one another up.
We are used to the darkness of this world. Fear is coming like a thief in the night. But the favor of the Lord God will be upon us.
To everyone who has, will more be given.
But we second recognize the abilities and opportunities he has given us. Let us favor of the Lord God be upon us.
The favor of the Lord is on you. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives you of all of your sins. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join us in singing Ancient of Days.
Rise up.
Almighty and ever-living God, you have given exceedingly great and precious promises to those who trust in you. Dispel from us
the works of darkness and grant us to live in the light of your Son, Jesus Christ, that our faith may never be found wanting.
To the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
The readings for today can be found starting on page 25 in the bulletin if you care to follow along. The first reading comes from the Old Testament book of Zephaniah, chapter 1, and reads as follows. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is near. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and consecrated his guests. And on the day of the Lord's sacrifice, I will punish the officials and the king's son, and all who array themselves in foreign attire. On that day, I will punish everyone who leaps over the threshold, and those who fill their master's house with violence and fraud. On that day, declares the Lord, a cry will be heard from the fish gate, a wail from the second quarter, a loud crash from the hills. Wail, O inhabitants of the mortar, for all the traitors are no more. All who weigh out silver are cut off. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the men who are complacent, those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do ill. Their goods shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty man cries aloud there. A day of wrath is that day, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of the light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. This is the word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of our gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted them to his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded with them and made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug it in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, 'Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here I have made 5 talents more.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master.' And he also who had the 2 talents came forward, saying, 'Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I have made 2 talents more.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master.' He also had received the 1 talent, came forward saying, 'Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours.' But his master answered him, 'You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was mine with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated and let us pray. Gracious God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Imagine receiving a diploma before you even started school. Or perhaps being hired for a job before you even had the interview. As strange as that sounds, that's exactly how we understand salvation. An absolute free gift that has no bearing on whether or not we earned it or deserve it. We believe in forensic justification. That's a big theological word. It just means that we are acquitted from sin. So we're declared righteous and holy. Maybe it doesn't mean that we are, just we're declared as such so that we could stand before God in his kingdom. And because we are declared as such, we have the freedom, therefore, to work towards becoming, throughout our lifetime, what we are declared to be. What we are declared to be. One example I thought about is, at least to my understanding, in the military, if you commission as an officer, you commission and then you go to training. It's the same way. We are saved and then we train in that salvation. St. Paul puts it best. In Philippians, and you've heard this passage before, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Not attain your salvation through fear and trembling. Work it out. Grow in it. Unpack it. Learn more about it. So today I want to use our lectionary readings the readings we just heard, to parse out this phrase a bit more. So with assistance from our readings today, work out your salvation with fear and trembling means, it means foregoing complacency in favor of steadfastness. It means being good stewards of God-given gifts. And finally, it means embracing the body of Christ, the church. Body of Christ, the church. As we said, salvation is a free gift from God through the merits of Christ alone. But like any gift, it can be squandered. What good is a Christmas present addressed to you if you leave it wrapped under the tree and never open it? I doubt that would ever happen. When I see a Christmas present with my name on it, I don't want to wait till Christmas, right? But what happened? It's no good. The same is true with our salvation. What good is it? What difference does it make if we don't unwrap it? If we don't unwrap it? Or we're complacent about it, as Zechariah contends from our first reading. On that day, he says, this is the second coming, what we talked about last week, the eschaton. On that day, I will search Jerusalem, he says, and punish the men who were complacent. Those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do ill. God's going to be indifferent, essentially. Now, compare this. Compare this to the Thessalonian reading, our second reading. Let us not sleep. Let us not sleep, teaches St. Paul. Let us not be indifferent, right? But let us keep awake. Let us stay awake and be sober. Let us stay awake and be sober. Complacency versus staying awake. In the 1930s, theologian H. Richard Niebuhr wrote a book called The Kingdom of God in America, and he was exploring how Christianity was changing in the 1930s. He was mostly lamenting about the rise of maybe what we would call progressive Christianity, a rise away from the Bible. Here's what he said about that. He said that this idea, this Christianity believed that a God without wrath brought men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through the ministrations of Christ without a cross. It's a big statement. And God without wrath brought men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through the ministry of Christ without a cross. Okay, so to live complacently with the gift of salvation, in light of that gift, is to live as if God cannot be wrathful. It's to live as if God is not capable of judging, which of course he is. It's to live as if you were not bought with a price, 1 Corinthians. It's to live as you were not bought with a price, the price, of course, being the death of Jesus on the cross. To stay awake, to be sober, is to live, as Martin Luther teaches in the Catechism, with fear and love of God. Right? Being in awe of his wrath, but also being overwhelmed by his love shown to us through his death on the cross. It's that balance, that fear and love is what helps us not be complacent. So before I turn to the parable and unpack this a little bit more, I have a question I want to pose to everyone out here today for you to think about. Can the world right now afford for Christians, for you, for me, to be complacent? Can we afford to sleep on truth? Can we afford to sleep on compassion? Can we afford to sleep on forgiveness? Can we afford it? Something for us to think about. We also work out our salvation by being good stewards of God-given spiritual gifts. God-given spiritual gifts. We focus a lot here in the church about what we're saved from, right? Sin, death, and the devil. But what are we saved to? Salvation, it comes from a Greek word that means deliverance. So you're being delivered to something. What is that to? What are we delivered to? Our baptismal liturgy is a great place to start. Each baptismal candidate receives a candle. And if you've been here to see a baptism, you know what I'm talking about. They receive a candle, and St. Matthew is paraphrased. Let your light so shine before others, they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven, is what we tell them. This means that God gives us the light or the spiritual gifts to share. Just like the man or the master from the parable who gave talents over two servants. They did not warrant these gifts, they were given. A talent, by the way, is a measure of money, it's currency, and it's 20 years worth of wages. 20 years worth of wages, which means it's the spiritual gifts that we receive from God, because this is a direct metaphor, the spiritual gifts we receive from God, whether it's teaching, whether it's encouragement, serving, leadership, whatever that spiritual gift is, these are substantial. 20 years worth of wages. They are not inconsequential. Also note that even the third servant, who received only one talent, still received a huge gift. 20 years of wages, $1 million. At least that would be for me. We may be tempted to compare ourselves to what others have, right? What you have is amazing. It's substantial too, no matter how small it is. A talent, 20 years worth of wages, that's immense. We all, therefore, have something to offer. I think this is part of the reason why we have the 10th commandment. Thou shalt not covet. My Old Testament professor, he taught that each commandment protected a gift from God. A good gift from God. Coveting is a sure way. It's a sure way of minimizing your spiritual gifts, isn't it? And not getting the most out of them because you're focusing on what somebody else has, what somebody else does. So refraining from coveting cultivates contentment and appreciation of what God gives. Of what God gives. Ultimately, however, it's not the magnitude of the gifts that we receive, but what we do with them. What we do with them. Now, the parable doesn't explicitly mention spiritual gifts, but the talents are definitely metaphors for spiritual gifts. But when Paul writes about the matter, he uses the Greek word charisma, for gift. That's the Greek word we see for gift in this context. Where we get the English word charisma. Now, that should tell us something about spiritual gifts. Charisma is active. Charisma is energetic. It's out front. It's loud. It's bold. It's moving. Spiritual gifts as charisma, then, are meant to be shared, cultivated, not hidden away or hoarded, which is precisely what the third servant does. He squanders his charisma, his gift, by bearing it, by not using it. And the master doesn't like that. And God doesn't like it either when we do it. Idle hands are the devil's workshop, Solomon teaches in Proverbs. And idle lips are his mouthpiece. God has given us charisma. He's given us these gifts to avoid idleness and its trouble. We have a call. We have a purpose. Do not neglect the gift you have, Paul tells Timothy in 1 Timothy. Do not neglect the gift, the charisma that you have. We cannot work out our salvation. We cannot grow into our salvation, unpack our salvation, if we forfeit our duties. We forfeit our duties to let our light shine, our charisma shine, through our various gifts. You remember the old Sunday school song. I'm not going to sing it, but you know it, right? This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel. Okay, I'm glad you guys remembered that. Hide it under a bushel, no. Thank goodness that William Wilberforce of England didn't hide his speaking and his gift of rhetoric under a bushel that led to the emancipation of slavery in Great Britain. Right? He was a Christian who used that gift for the kingdom. Thank goodness that William Booth didn't squander his gift of service and his heart for service, his charisma for that, under a bushel, which led now to nearly 30 million people a year being serviced by the Salvation Army. Thank goodness. So what will the world miss? What will the world miss if you hide your charisma, if you bury your light, your gift? What will the world miss out on? It's a question for us to ask. Now, we are told that the third servant buried his gift because of fear. Fear. Now, fear and awe of the master is not the problem, because we talked about that we need that balance between fear. We need that balance between fear and trust, fear and love. He forgot the second part, which is to trust or to love. If we only fear God, like the third servant feared his master, then we too might be hesitant to work out our salvation by letting our gifts shine. We might turn inward and doubt our God-given abilities, or even doubt God himself. Now keep this in mind, that Timothy was Paul's protege. And perhaps, you know, he was a young man, he was called to do ministry in various parts of the world. And perhaps he was in fear of what God had called him to do. Which is why Paul reminds him, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love. This is what he writes to Timothy. Don't be afraid. For God gave us a spirit of not of fear, but of power and love. Now, Paul is doing exactly what he tells us to do in the Thessalonian text that we read today, in today's reading. Encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. Encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. For us to work out our salvation, we must lean on the church, the ecclesia, the people who make up the body of Christ. As iron sharpens iron, man sharpens man. The physical presence of other Christians, wrote Dietrich Bonhoeffer, is the source of incomparable joy and strength to the believer. Strength to the believer. In the early church, before Constantine legalized Christianity, persecutions of Christians would sometimes give way to times of peace. During one of those stretches, one author tells a story of a Roman emperor who was impressed with the vast growth of Christianity and was therefore convinced that Christians must have vast wealth somewhere to power this machine. And so he summoned a bishop to his palace, and he ordered him to produce the treasures of the church. The bishop protested. The church has no gold, no jewels or other valuables, which was certainly true in that time of history. But the emperor brushed aside this objection and demanded the riches of the church be brought to him in the morning. The next day, the bishop dutifully appeared at the palace doorway, empty-handed. "I told you to bring me the treasures of the church," demanded the emperor. The bishop then invited the emperor to look at the palace steps, to look out at the palace steps. Gathered together, peering sheepishly at the great doors of the royal palace, rising above them was a mass of common people, including ragged, beggars, cripples, slaves, outcasts, people of all walks of life. With a sweep of the hand, right? The bishop said, "These are the treasures of the church. These are the treasures of the church." Indeed, the strength, indeed the growth of the church came not from wealth, but from the power of community, the power of the fellowship of the saints. It came from each person in the body boldly staying awake, shrugging off complacency. It came from the members of the body not bearing their gifts, not bearing their charisma. It came through working out their salvation. So surrounded by the saints as inspiration, surrounded by the saints as inspiration, let us pick up the mantle and continue to work out our salvation for each other and for the world. For we do indeed have treasure to offer. Thanks be to God.
Please rise and join us in singing Give Thanks.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again.
The church, the world, and for one another. Almighty God, thank you for entrusting us the treasures of your kingdom and the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your confidence in us, for commending wise risk-taking and commending fearful in action. Give us grace to be faithful stewards of your bounty, to your glory, and for the good of your people. Lord, in your mercy. Give your church pastors, bishops, and theologians who faithfully proclaim your word of law and gospel. Make the church shine with the holiness and humility of Jesus, guiding many to seek his promised forgiveness and salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, let the faithful witness of your suffering church be a beacon of hope for all who love Christ, and into an urgent warning to all who hate him. We can scarcely comprehend the suffering of our persecuted sisters and brothers. Give us the willingness to defend and provide for them as we can, and to adorn their sacrifices with our smaller acts of faith and love. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, make this congregation into a discipleship boot camp. Teach us to practice taking risk in your service. Make us bold in granting forgiveness or asking for it. Make us brave in talking about the hope that is in us. Make us fearless in shining the light of Jesus' love into sin-darkened lives. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, give teachable minds and willing hearts to the leaders of this nation and all the nations. Remind them that they must give you an account of their stewardship of power, authority, and talents. Do not let them squander these gifts through hard hearts, rivalries, misuse, or disuse. Give to each of us the gifts of kindness, humility, generosity, so that all our lives may be touched by happiness and brightened by hope. Lord, in your mercy. We beseech you, Almighty God, that you come speedily to the rescue of all who cry out for the healing of body, mind, heart, or spirit, including all those in our congregation, on our prayer list, on our prayer chain. Deliver them, Lord, from their afflictions, and restore them to the fellowship of all who care for them. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer, and graciously grant all that glorifies you and benefits our poor, broken world. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the peace of Christ. Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember to confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us, Lord, in your kingdom, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God, for the people of God. Come, taste and see that our Lord is good. Amen.
Please be seated. We will commune one side of the congregation at a time,
starting with the pulpit side and then moving to the lectern side.
You are Lord.
We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Please join us in singing the closing song, I Know That My Redeemer Lives.
Thanks be to God.